Hello, welcome to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay. I'm absolutely thrilled this week because I've got two of my favourite people in the room. Two people that I have performed with many times now. And so I'm delighted to welcome to the studio Tom Sturgey from Ridgeview Wine Estate.
Hello, hello.
And of course, the delightful Jason Sutton. Not that Tom isn't delightful, Tom's delightful as well. Sorry. I'm demeaning you though, not saying you're delightful too.
Straight out the
bat. We've worked together now, all of us, separately, for some years. Tom and I have been working together for a few years now.
Six years. I reckon, five and a half, something like that.
And I've been associated with Ridgeview for even longer.
All of that time and more.
And it's a local wine estate that makes, I think, one of the best sparkling wines that you can actually buy.
Bless you.
And it's my go-to, it's my favourite. And of course, Jason, who everyone in Brighton knows as Miss Jason, but you're here in civvies today.
Yes, lovely, no high heels.
People
nice
don't often see you like this, do you,
on
television?
No, it's nice. It's
and we're
nice
going to talk about
your
latest show, latest TV show, Jason's Gadabout, which I had the pleasure of being a guest on.
Very nice.
The Christmas show, which was fantastic fun.
And now the tables have turned.
Absolutely.
Indeed, yes.
Well, yes, because I'm much nicer to my guests than Miss Jason is.
Very good.
She's a wicked old bees and
Yes. Anarchy, anyway.
That's all right, that's fine.
This is far more organised and calm.
Well, it started out that way.
Yeah,
we've done things together where they've started out very calm, haven't they? And they're all with all best intentions.
Yes,
and then we've got a couple of bottles of wine.
To this man and someone else trying to strip me on stage.
Oh, goodness. Like,
at a wine tasting.
It was only reciprocated from what we had already had, you know, attempts to be done to us.
Well, just for the record, I'm keeping my clothes on.
Me too.
So am I today. Yeah. We don't have wide angle lenses.
Well,
so,
there you go.
You know, it would be horrible.
Too cold for me to strip.
Let's talk a little bit about the Gadabout, because you've done quite a lot of them now.
Yeah, we just finished the second series.
Yes.
And the thing about the Gadabout is it's just complete madness. And I go off and visit a town or a little village or something and speak to local people. And it's always the people that live there that are actually the comedy in it.
They're the half of the show, aren't they?
The great British public are exactly that, great. And they're very funny. So I speak to local people and go to local places, and then the panel have to guess where we are.
Nice.
So
okay,
through
perfect.
Asking all sorts of questions, none of them are ever clever questions, I'm afraid. It's always a bit mad, and we do it with a studio audience. So it's just a nice kind of mad hour, isn't it?
And I mean, do you find it's essential to have that audience there, Jason?
I like it, but that's because my background is in cabaret, as you know.
Yes.
So I like that interaction with an audience. And I think that comedy is a bit like a game of tennis. The ball has to... It's a volley, isn't it? You know, and the minute the ball hits the ground, then the comedy's gone. So to share with the panel and with the audience, I think is what makes it special and lively. And, you know, laughter is a wonderful thing to
be surrounded by. Well, your act is very different from a lot of people's acts. And in that you don't write material down.
No,
everything you do is a spontaneous reaction to the people in the room. Whereas most people go out and you go and see quite a lot of cabaret acts and you see them one week and you went back to see them the next week. It's the same show and the same gags. Yours isn't like that at all.
Well, I personally would find that boring. A lot of people like to do that because I guess it's a comfort thing to know where you're going, but I prefer not to know, so it's a bit of a roller coaster.
There's a bit of a confidence in that, isn't there? There's, you know,
it can go terribly wrong.
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes, I mean, I can run in high heels, and with my act, I've had to a couple of times, but it's lovely when you really don't know where it's going, and then it's exciting for you as well, and I think the audience pick up on that.
Oh, yes.
And you share it, and I think the nice thing about working with people is there can be a group of people, and you can break into the sanctity of that group by making a comment, not a wicked comment, but a comment about one of them.
What do you mean, not a wicked comment? That's such a
lie. If you was in a group of people and someone, say, had a red tie with white spots on, everyone in the group might think, whoa, that's a bit over the top. But the person wearing it, so the person wearing it thinks, oh, this is fab. And then you break into it, and you're saying what the group means.
Yeah.
I love your tie, but I'm just using that as an example.
It is wonderful to watch.
Yeah.
You walk onto the stage, and I can see you do this around the room because you're looking for targets, aren't you?
Well, yeah, and also people that you know you can't mess about with. I mean, that's the art of it, I think. Picking up who you can't say things to. And I've learned that the hard way.
Yeah.
You know, and got into trouble a couple of times.
Because it's dangerous, isn't it? It's edgy.
Yeah. But that's why it's, for me, that's why it's exciting. But then we all work differently, don't we? But the cabaret circuit is full of very varied people. But I couldn't tie myself down to a script or a set of gags or anything like that.
I saw you on Sunday and you were performing at the Bali Brasserie. It was a wonderful, wonderful day. But there was a table of young men at the end who really, really wanted to be on stage with you. I mean, does that often happen?
Yes, well, people like to join in, don't they? So
he certainly wanted to join in.
That's fair enough. Yeah, they were.
And it's a two-way conversation, like you said.
Well, they were just frustrated showgirls, weren't they?
They were.
You know, I mean, one of them had just had a load of Botox done. I think she wanted to show it off there. That's what that was all about.
I mean, honestly, you know, chin was actually a kneecap.
There you go, quite, yeah. Oh, wow.
Well, listen, the Christmas gadabout has been recorded.
Yeah, we're done.
And I know that the lovely Lourdes has edited it. And let's have a quick look at something from the first half so we don't give anything away. But we'll take a look at that now. If you could roll that VT for me, Zahira, that would be lovely.
I shall introduce you to my panel. I'm going to say, I know you shouldn't have favourites, but I can't help it because look at the alternative. I'm going to start by introducing you to our lovely Euro sensation, Nikki French.
Merry Christmas.
And also, let's introduce Andrew Kay, a.k.a. Souffle, Queer. I don't know what that is, but it's a brand program. And a very serious presenter here on Latest TV, so we've allowed him to come out after the watershed so he can let his head, well, whatever he's got down anyway. But there, you can say a couple of swear words if you like, darling. OK, that's very good. Oh, I'm joined by the other side.
Hello, my
little wing woman.
How are you, darling?
I'm all right, dear. We're both dressed as Mother Christmas this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll allow you to decide which one you'd like to slip down your chimney. But I've got a feeling Christmas might last a little longer with her jammed down your flue. Anyway, boys and girls, it's the Venus Model! Tonight, yes. Uh-huh. I knew we were going to get lots of that, I should think. We got the one and only Elvis, boys and girls. While I'm with you, Elvis.
Yeah.
How are you, dear? Are you excited to be here on the house party?
I'm all shook up.
I can see you.
Are you
all shook up?
Well, no, I'm sitting next to Elvis.
JCB to shake you up, dear. And Andrew is another Miss Jason's house party virgin, dear.
I know.
How are you, darling?
I'm very well, thank you.
Are you excited?
Overexcited. I'm glad.
I can see you're overexcited by your jumper, darling.
Let me just say, he did this himself.
You made it yourself.
I did. I know.
There you are. That's Peter care moment. Of the community, boys and girls. That's lovely. Anyway, before we do anything, I feel that we need a little trick. My wig is wonky because they didn't give me time to. Can you do?
You wear a wig?
They didn't give me. Yeah. Oh no! Now they know I'm not a real woman. Boys and girls, we need a little drink. We've got our special wait. I can't bear that hair. We got our special waitress here. We got our lovely Elaine. She's a little bit deaf. So after three, I want you all to help me shout her name. So it's Elaine. One, two, three. Elaine! Come on, dear. Here she comes.
Well, it's wonderful. It's absolutely hilarious. And I mean, you talk about my spotty tie here, but what about that spotty jumper?
Well, was a creation. And you'd made that yourself.
I made it for you. It was my Blue Peter moment. I was channeling Janet Ellis.
Janet Ellis.
Well, I'm saying that to make you think I'm younger than I am. I was actually really channeling Valerie Singleton, of course.
Now, I can remember Valerie Singleton. Who was Janet Ellis then?
Janet Ellis was much later. Yeah, I don't remember her really. Oh. I only know the name because my cousin is also.
Well, you're the youngest.
I know none of these. I'm adrift. I know none of them. That's it. But I loved it. I thought it was fun.
It is really good fun. It's it sort of marks the end of your cabaret season as well, doesn't it?
It does. Because next
week you're off to Richmond.
Yes.
To be in pantomime.
Oh yeah.
And When we come back after the break, we're going to talk about pantomime because Tom has pantomime history too.
This is it, very much. I do, I totally do. I've been on the opposite side of the fence, so I'm a pantomime widow. You know, while Olivia was out and about my other half, I was the one who was at home waiting
Excellent.
For Christmas to come.
Right, we're going to go to a break. We'll see you in a moment.
Look out! We're here for you.
Hello, welcome back to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay, and my guest Tom Sturgey and Jason Sutton. Jason, off to Richmond.
Yes,
in
next
yet
Monday.
Another panto.
Well, this is my 10th anniversary.
Fantastic.
So I'm very excited to be in Richmond. It's a theatre that I've loved for years but never had the opportunity to work it. So to go there is really, really exciting.
And it's, I mean, it feels like you're getting close to the heart of London, doesn't it?
Yeah, I like to be in and around London. I work for Kudos and they've got theatres all over the place and they've kind of kept me in and around London for the last few years, which I like because it's
Yes, because you could end up in Sunderland, couldn't you?
I could go wherever they send me.
Is that how it works? Literally,
absolutely
you, it's
no
luck of the draw.
At all, no,
wow.
Just, but they've been very kind to me, touch wood.
And you're Nurse Nancy this year.
I am Nurse Nancy again in Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
Is it a new script?
It's not a new script, but there's a lot more material in it for me.
Well, one of the things that's important about pantomime is this. I love pantomime. You know I love pantomime. But I love the fact that a good pantomime works on two levels. There is something in it for the kids that they get, and then floating above it on a level of mild filth and double entendre. And that has to be topical, doesn't it?
Yeah, there's a good old... I was reading the script the other day. Of course, I'm reading it all the time, so I know it when I get there. But there's quite a lot of naughtiness in it. It's quite bold, you know?
Yeah.
And I thought, ooh. But I'm really, really looking forward to it. I did Snow White last year. It's the same director, a guy called Stuart Nichols, and he is absolutely incredible to work with. And a couple of the dancers and a couple of the lads that were in last year are back this year. And I'm with Jo Brand this year, which I'm looking forward
Wonderful.
To.
Wonderful. She's playing the Wicked Queen.
She's the Wicked Queen, yeah.
Fantastic.
So I've got some really nice scenes with her. So, I'm really, really looking forward to it.
That's very exciting to be working with someone if you admire them as well,
oh,
isn't
absolutely,
it?
Yeah.
And she is marvellous.
Yeah, she is. Yeah. She is. I'm really, really looking forward to it.
So with how topical that can you slightly change the script as you go along? There's got to be a bit of margin for leeway,
well,
isn't
there? Yes. I think, well, as the dame, and certainly as the comic, you can play a little bit, but only a little bit, because obviously people are dependent on you saying the right thing at the right time.
Is this true?
So it's not just giving people their cue that the other actors are around you, but it's giving the lighting people a cue or whoever's calling the show. So they know that when you're saying that and you're stood there, this is an expert that's going to happen. So you can kind of fiddle a little bit with the middle, but as long as you start
You've
in the right
You've got to get
place
back.
And you end in the right place, then you're okay. But I'm, just in case my boss is watching this, which I'm sure they do, I'm always stick to the schedule and I'm never naughty. I'm always on time. I'm a model company member.
You're very professional.
I'm a member, can't even say it. Yes.
And I know that because we worked together this year with the play. Choreography, dancing, do you get to do a lot?
Yeah, and I like it.
Do you?
I like it, yeah. It's really. I'm not, obviously, we can see.
You see, you don't come from a stage school background.
No, not at
Most
all.
Of the kids who do pantomime are pretty fresh out of stage schools.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I always laugh when people say, oh, such a body on Strictly is really good. And, you know, they never danced before. I'm thinking, do you know something? They're professional actors. They went to stage school.
Yeah.
They will have done some dance.
I love
but
it.
But you've not, have
no,
you?
No, not at all. Absolutely not at all.
I mean, your background is politics.
Yeah, yeah. So I did a bit of dancing, I suppose. but, no, I like the dancing. I like to get in there with the kids and think that I'm all fit and trendy and all that. the only problem is not having any formal training. When a choreographer says, can you do a doo-de-doo-de-da-da, of course, I don't know what to do.
No, quite. Not
got a clue.
And it makes everyone laugh, and I said, well, I'm sorry, I don't know what that is, dear. You're going to have to explain it to me. But what I love about the whole experience of panto is first day, you're all thrown together, loads of strangers, and slowly this grows around you, and then yeah. the basis is there, and then once you start to put the layers on, so you learn the numbers, and then you start doing the dancing, and then, because the dialogue comes in, and slowly, 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 it's, I suppose it's like cooking a lovely cake. Eventually, it's time to take it out of the oven and let everybody have a slice.
Did you grow up with pantomime, Tom?
I got taken to it. So we grew up slightly closer along the A27 to Eastbourne than Brighton. So I used to go down to Eastbourne quite a lot down there, Devonshire Park and all that. And then later on in my life, when I was living in London, Olivia, my wife, old then girlfriend, was an actress. And yes. so she did panto for 3 years running in Broxbourne and in Sevenoaks and places like that. So she was quite lucky. She was always relatively local. And she did, what did she do? Things like Jack and the Beanstalk, she did brilliantly. So I'm aware of the commitment and the amount of time, because people think of them as being a really festive thing, which obviously they are. Mm. But they stretch from November through to January and, you know, way beyond.
I promise you, when I was growing up, pantomime yeah. opened on Boxing Day and ran till Easter.
Gosh. There you go.
I mean, a long, long
yeah,
time.
Yeah, it's huge.
And my first ever pantomime that I saw was at Liverpool Empire in 1959. With Tommy Steele in Mother Goose.
Oh, really?
And it was wonderful. It was just... And I became hooked. And I've loved it ever since. I love everything since. But I miss things. Do you miss the fact that these days we're seeing dames that aren't men and principal boys that aren't girls?
Certainly, I got my love of panto when I was a child. My mum and dad always used to take me to pantomime at Christmas. And do you know, the weird thing is that obviously the principal boy was played by a female, but I can't even remember thinking that the principal boy was a female.
Well, it was just normal, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it never occurred to me that it was wrong. But then I always loved the dames anyway, so yeah. whilst all the other little boys and girls were loving the male lead or the female lead, I was only interested in the campery, really. But as I say, 10 years, in all the time I've worked, I've never worked with a female principal boy.
No, and there was, of course, that yeah. moment in history when suddenly every pantomime had to have a soap star in it.
Of course.
And soap stars, I mean, TV soap acting is wonderful, and I'm completely obsessed with Coronation Street, as anyone who knows me knows. But I've seen some very poor performances from stars from other media. Uh-huh. Out on those stages, and you were telling a story on Sunday, and we won't name the person, about a performer who really, oh, really didn't cut it in a pantomime that you were in with Lynn.
Yes, no, we definitely can't tell that story. But, so sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, but I have to say I've been really fortunate. The majority of the people that I've worked with have been great, yeah. great people on and off stage. And in a pantomime, it's so important that you all get on, because it's such a yeah. tight-knit family for mm-hmm. a long time. I mean, this to me will be 6 weeks with the rehearsal period. Mm-hmm. So, it's important that everybody gets on. And
it's a long time away from home as well.
Yeah, I think I might commute this time because it's Richmond. And I've
that's
got a little
easy
dog,
enough.
You see.
That's fine. Okay.
So I can't find accommodation. So if anyone is watching that's got a house in Richmond that I could rent for 6 weeks, or a flat, then they
with
don't
the
mind having
there
a dog.
There you go. It's like pet rescue.
He's so tiny.
Oh, yes, he's only
tiny. He's like that big.
That closeness I remember really distinctly. So actually a number of our absolute best friends in the world who we see regularly and, you know, who live all over the country, you know, because of the nature of panto, come from Olivia having done pantomimes. Right. And you spend so much time together, don't you? And I was completely obsessed. And I went to see her in Broxbourne, I think, sort of 8 times over the run of it, mainly just to see her, you know, and actually sort of spend some time in the interval, which is great. And actually, when I asked her to marry me, the ring that I used was Olivia's great-grandparents.
I was going to say, it wasn't one from the panto.
And the diamond had fallen out, and we put a diamond into it, so I was quite lucky the ring was already there. And I had to do a trade with Olivia's mum, who was the current owner of that ring, and we did it at the panto. There was a little exchange that went on. So panto's got a lot, you know, it's got a lot, you know, running now, through my life. It's great.
That's
your role at Richview
yeah.
is very much about
a pantomime.
Selling the brand.
Yeah.
But I know for a fact that you are very much a performer.
Yeah.
And you like being on centre stage, don't you?
I do. I love it. And I think my role at Richview what's really lucky about it, because on paper, I'm the business and the business development and sales director. So on paper, that could be quite dry, could be quite sort of
sounds
commercial.
Sounds boring.
Yeah, exactly. And there's the odd spreadsheet, but then I get to do things like this and avoid it. And the balance of those two things is essential, because anybody that's ever worked with me in an office, which is not the capacity you've ever worked with me in, knows that I'm awful. I tap, I drum, I sing, I'm just a sort of little ball of energy. So performing is everything. And for something like Ridgeview, which is a traditional method, English sparkling wine, quite a sort of premium price point product, but in a category that didn't exist 30 years ago. So, you know, really we're building this brand new market, mm-hmm. and communication is everything for that. So what I love about my job is I do get to perform, and it's about bringing the story to life. And Ridgeview's got a story that most brands would kill for, you know, just authentically there. So I get to go out and tell it, and I like that, which is good.
Well, it's wonderful. We're going to go to a break in a moment. When we come back, I think we need to bring the third guest onto the show. Mm. And that third guest is, of course, something to drink. Now, I know you don't touch alcohol,
not normally,
Jason.
But I might make an exception.
You make an exception today. Because it would be rude not to, wouldn't it?
Oh, absolutely.
So in the interests of business.
Completely.
And being professional.
Yes.
We'll come back and we'll have a look at Ridgeview, the thing, the real thing. We'll see you after these ads.
Look out, we're here for you.
Hello, welcome back to Look Out with me, Andrew Kay. I'm joined in the sofa this week by Tom Sturgey and Jason Sutton. And Tom, Ridgeview.
I've brought some booze.
I know.
Come on.
I mean, it would be rude not
welcome.
To taste it.
It's got to be done. I brought two bottles, so we're all right. It's good. Yep. We're going to go with that.
Oh, yes. Jason and I both have capacity.
But there are three of us, dear.
Yeah, quite. Exactly that. Yeah, I'll go without. It's fine. It'll be fine. Two straws coming right up.
So how long has Ridgeview been around?
So we've made wine now for 25 years. So in January, so in 2000, in what year is it? 2019. In 2020, it's going to be our 25th anniversary. So we're preparing for that. So 25 years makes it 1995 when we started.
I noticed how professionally did he do that.
That's good.
The twist of the bottle.
We try. It's just lots of time and practice, isn't it, basically? And it's, you know... It helps working wine. We're going to start with that, and then, you know, we'll begin like that, and we'll top you up as you go along.
Now, one of the interesting things about Ridgeview is in the last year or so, the branding has changed, and you've gone for something which is less old-school, making it look like champagne.
Yeah, it was really intentional, and it was Mardy who... So Ridgeview, I suppose, founding thing of it is Ridgeview's a family business.
Yes.
And the Roberts right at the very centre of it, the second generation of them, the kids of Mike and Chris, are now at the forefront of that business. Simon, the head winemaker, his wife Mardy is Australian, grew up in a sort of winemaking region out there, and Mardy looks after all of our marketing. And Mardy really wanted, over the last few years, and it was a project that took 3 or 4 years, to stop us looking like a 300-year-old company and I suppose looking a little like a classic champagne or something like that, and actually being quite brave and looking like a 25-year-old company, which we are. And the way that we did that was we cleaned it up. You know, we sort of cleaned up all the lines.
All the frills.
Simplified it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we kept the fun bits. So sort of there was always colour in the labels. So we kept this sort of sash at the top of it and wanted that to be there. But just neatened it up, cleaned it a bit.
Very smart. Wow. So what have we got here?
So we're going to do two wines. First wine is Bloomsbury. This is our signature wine. This is the wine most people sort of are introduced to us through. It's in Waitrose, so it's quite accessible.
It's in the Bloomsbury Hotel.
It's very much in the Bloomsbury Hotel.
And I spotted online there's a fantastic offer. If you go to the Bloomsbury Hotel in the Christmas period, you can have a flight of
it's
wines
bonkers.
With a plate of truffled France.
Literally that. So it was an idea that I came up with literally over a glass of wine with Anne, who's their master of wine, who looks after that side of things. And usually you have to be careful with sommeliers. You know, having been one, I can talk about that. You know, with objectively. Usually, I'll make suggestions or won't be brave enough to make suggestions, and very rarely are they taken up. But Anne's amazing and really open-minded. So when I said, "Look, I think we ought to do something fun over Christmas," they've just won the sort of best wine list in town, best English wine list in town, and so we thought, "Look, let's do something to celebrate that." We are Ridgeview have just been named the International Winemakers of the Year at the IWSC, so it's this right. Let's do something fun. And she came up with the idea of serving something like the Blanc de Blanc and Blanc de Noir, our two top wines, side by side, giving people the opportunity to taste two amazing, very different wines. And then that got extended to, well, if you're going to do two, you may as well do three, much like you alluded to when we started. Sorry, I only brought two. And so the idea is it comes on this lovely afternoon tea stand, and you go, as you have your three glasses, as you go up the stand, they get increasingly higher price point, but each is stylistically very different. And then my idea within it was truffle and Parmesan fries on the side, which...
What's not to love?
It's got to be fun. There needs to be some kind of... Food and wine go hand in hand, but a big part of the Ridgeview thing is trying to make a really luxurious, sort of high-quality product accessible to a degree, you know, and enjoyable for people. And I think, yeah, truffle and Parmesan fries help with that. It's a bit of opulence.
Tell us about this one.
So, Bloomsbury. This is all about Chardonnay. So we use three great varieties, Chardonnay, Pinot Noir, Pinot Meunier. They're all grown in East and West Sussex. We've also got a little vineyard on the sort of Kent border. There's a bit in Hampshire. We're doing some work in Suffolk and that sort of way now as well. So there's a diverse sort of number of sources of the fruit. And they're all growers that we've worked with for a number of years. But the winery itself is in Ditchling, just north of Brighton. And we only work with those three varieties. So Chardonnay, which is the dominant variety in Bloomsbury, is kind of like lemon citrus flavours and green apples and sort of white peaches and kind of bright, citrusy, zesty kind of styles of wine. And that's most of what this wine tastes like. One third of the blend, though, is a bit of Pinot Noir and Pinot Meunier. And Pinot Noir and Meunier are softer, a bit more rounded, a bit more sort of like red berry fruits and blueberry flavours.
So they even it out.
They even it out a bit. They stop it being too acidic and sort of lean and sort of firm in its attack, and they just make it easy drinking, is the idea. So what we want with this wine is it just to be fun. It's perfect at Christmas. Smoked salmon. This is breakfast wine for sure on Christmas Day.
Do we like a bottle of breakfast wine?
And so it should just be nice and fresh and bright and easy drinking. And England is set up to do that. You know, England makes super fine, really concentrated fruit flavour sparkling wines because it's such a cold climate. It's quite a challenging place to do it.
Part of your job is actually taking these wines to the rest of the world.
Yeah.
And I've drunk this wine in Sweden.
You have?
Vancouver.
Yep.
Sicily.
Amsterdam. No, Den Haag.
Den Haag. That's another story.
There you go.
And Rotterdam, which is a terrifying story. But it is out there. It's gaining popularity. How difficult is it for you to sell English sparkling wine in a country that makes its own sparkling wine?
So it's more difficult somewhere that has a really long history of it and makes its own. So France is the epitome of that.
Can you get Ridgeview in Paris?
Yeah, you can. There's a wine shop called Voyageurs de Vin, and the idea there is they are sort of sailing around the world, finding the best wines they can, which is still quite a novel idea, genuinely. But which is sort of fair enough, because France has made wine for forever. It's made sparkling wines like this in Champagne since the sort of very late 1600s, whereas we've only been doing it since sort of, you know, very late 80s, early 90s, so fair enough. And France is lucky because it's got almost every kind of climate you could wish for. If you want really rich, robust, ripe wines, you go to somewhere hot, and if you want something lean and acidic, go somewhere cold, and they've got everything in between. We sell loads of wine to France, though, and the reason for that is we work with a little wine shop in Antibes, an English couple who set that up. Actually, she's Aussie, he's English, and they used to work on yachts, and now they sell our wines onto yachts down in Antibes.
Wow.
So not many French people are drinking it, I don't think. But, you know, on paper, loads goes
God bless the expats.
I know.
Absolutely.
But we do export a lot. So we're in 18 countries around the world now. And kind of as you alluded to, the most successful markets are the ones who are quite modern in terms of their food scene. So the Scandinavian markets are amazing. Norway, Sweden, Finland. Denmark are causing me a little bit of trouble at the moment. Denmark's slowed down,
really?
But that's all right. Yeah, they like it quite, you know, on a very broad sense. They look quite like natural wines. They're looking for sort of real minimal intervention organic, and which isn't something we are. It's something
I found
we,
that
we
when
respect,
I went to
but it's not
a wine exhibition with Richie in Helsinki.
Yeah.
And there were a lot of natural wines
there. So a lot of that going on.
That was a very boozy weekend away.
That's it, it does tend to be, that's it. But places like Norway are great because they have a climate that doesn't necessarily produce wine itself. There are some vineyards out there now, but not on a world stage. And they also haven't got the, I suppose, historical idea that champagne is the only sparkling and Bordeaux and Burgundy are the best of the white, you know, whites and reds. And so they've got this amazing food scene and they really celebrate local ingredients, but they're quite open-minded to wine from all over the place.
Yeah.
But really, you know, we're in the UK, London is one of the centres of the gastronomic world for sure, and we're served by a large number
That's not
of really
our
great
Brighton
places.
Chef friends, though.
No, this is true. Brighton,
they,
very
they
much
do
the same.
Love to think that this is here.
And as you know, we're huge ambassadors for Brighton.
Absolutely.
And so we try and be very supportive of the whole scene here, and there are a number of unbelievable restaurants.
I'm finding myself looking at that bottle.
I was thinking,
if I keep looking at it, eventually it's going to pour
it. Let's give it a go. Let's give it a go.
Bully you.
Jason does like to be topped.
Excellent.
Yes, absolutely.
It's hot in here, isn't it? It's evaporating.
It's very warm in here.
Now, what we're doing here is I wanted to show you two very different types of wine. We produce six at Ridgeview. And this is the opposite. This is all about Pinot Noir and Pinot Meunier. It's got very little, it's got no Chardonnay in it, it's a Blanc de Noir. And so Blanc de Noirs are like rich and savory and earthy and full-bodied, and all the flavors are sort of red berry fruits and licorice and sort of, structure. It's also aged for twice as long in the cellar. So the idea with these kind of wines is a lot of their flavor comes from aging.
It's massively different, isn't it?
Big time.
Incredibly different, yeah.
And I think food pairing wise, you know, we talked about this a little bit off air, but you know, things like oysters and shellfish and anything that comes off Brighton Beach, give or take, within reason, fish and chips, something like that, Bloomsbury would be ideal for. Something Chardonnay and zippy and fresh, you know, that's great. That's Christmas morning wine. This though, Blanc de Noir, is that's the sort of Christmas dinner table sort of thing. It's like rich, it's full. If you had anything from the sort of English game season,
Goose,
that would be amazing.
Partridge,
completely.
Absolutely.
And I think people still don't think of sparkling wine as being something you drink, you know, at all occasions and throughout a meal or anything like that.
We're going to drink it through the break,
I'm afraid.
With a bit of luck, there'll be some food ads coming up for you now. We'll make this make sense. We'll see you after these ads. Oh, Tom, my glass is empty.
Come on, let's give it a go.
Guess what? So
give me the posh one.
Look at you, both of you. Unbelievable. There's almost nothing left in this
lovely,
now.
Lovely. Make it sound like we've been boozing in the interval. Of course we haven't.
No, not
at all. It is delicious. It's wonderful.
Isn't it Christmas?
Would you buy this?
Oh, most certainly, yes. It would be very nice if, when I was to arrive at Richmond, perhaps on the opening night, if a bottle
There's
was...
one sitting in the dressing room.
It was such a lovely surprise.
That could be it, couldn't it? That's
Can I give you my details?
Richmond 30 is it? That's it?
Yes.
There you go. We've all had a drink. We've all had a drink. All right. You know.
We've been talking in the break about quality over quantity, and I said that I would rather have a glass of this than half a bottle of Plonk over dinner with a friend.
Without question.
And I think we are changing our tastes. I mean, I must confess that a lot of restaurants now offer flights of wine, which I really like, although some restaurants are rather mean with their flights and you get a dribble in the bottom. I'm not going to say what I usually describe that as. And others are very generous. I mean,
a flight at Etch
is actually a night out on the booze.
Yeah, completely.
They're very generous and they serve wonderful wines.
you would, I often think, I'm often surprised, because we do lots of wine dinners where we'll do sort of six wines and six courses sort of thing. I'm always amazed at quite how much people can drink if they're eating along with it, you know. Yes. And it's really hugely different having six small glasses of wine, each with some food spread out over 2.5 hours, as opposed to six glasses of wine very, very quickly. But the whole quantity, the whole quality over quantity thing, we're all moving towards it. And it sort of sits in that same bracket as sustainable sourcing of food and sort of this whole sort of mental and physical health thing. We all need to be looking after each other a little bit. And alcohol in huge quantities, nobody's suggesting is a good thing. So premium, really sort of top-end wines.
I don't know why I'm smiling at
that. I don't know why it's smiling either.
Well, it can be a good thing.
Yeah,
yeah, exactly. Pick
this,
your moments.
This man on stage drinks... was performing.
I love it.
So suddenly no you were drinking shots of some unmentionable drink.
Drinking as you go.
A terrible.
I thought
life,
I had a good
it?
Job.
It's terrible, on. Isn't it? But no, but yes, I do. No, I like a booze, dear, and this is very, very nice.
Bless
I
you.
Shall get myself up to Waitrose now.
Bless you.
It's actually worth looking on the supermarket website. Mm-hmm. Occasionally, you will find, and I shouldn't be saying this with Richview in the room, but occasionally you spot that. Somewhere we'll have Richview on offer.
It happens rarely, but it does happen. It does happen. There is, and it's that thing. It's completely out of our control. But it's one of those things that as we grow as a business and we're out there in the world more, if somebody chooses to do that, they choose to do that a bit. There might be one that's about to happen somewhere. Actually, that
really?
I heard rumours of. Yeah, off in about a week's time.
Well,
there you go.
You also make wines for other people as well, don't you? You make wines for Laithwaite's, and I know you make a sparkling wine for Marks and Spencer.
We do. We do.
Which is delicious.
It's great.
It's called Huntsman.
Marksman. Really close. Marksman. So yeah,
I was in Manchester. And I was trying to buy a bottle of Ridgeview to take to my cousin because I was going to stay with.
Yeah,
him.
Yeah, yeah.
And
no
way could not find Ridgeview. Not in the centre of the city. And I thought, I know what I can do. I can go to Marks and Spencer's. It will be, but it won't be the label.
They are sensational wines. They are amazing. They're Blanc de Blanc, and they are ridiculously good value. It's about 25 quid.
It's really good value.
So it's even sort of, it's more entry price point than our Bloomsbury. And that's something we've always done. So we've worked with the Laithwaite's family at Direct Wines for a long time and made wines called Southridge for them. Waitrose, we have a very close relationship with, and their Leckford estate. Out in Hampshire, they planted a vineyard a number of years ago, and they send the fruit to us, which we then produce their Leckford Estate Brut from. I think I'm allowed to say that. That's all good. there's a vineyard. Yeah, quiet. There's a vineyard in the Great Windsor Park, in the grounds, the Royal Grounds.
Yes.
And the fruit from that comes to us, and we produce a wine with Laithwaite's for that. And so there's a number of things we do, and really, they're all fantastic wines. The focus for us is the Ridgeview label wines. That's the sort of bedrock. But we're quite a rare beast in the world of luxury sparkling wines, where in that we don't sort of make handbags or something else that then covers the costs of you know, doing that, which a number of other famous champagne houses and things do. And so we compete in this sphere that is often backed by large amounts of money. And we aren't that. We were founded by Mike and Chris. They invested everything in it, and we have to be a little bit profitable just to keep going. We're a genuinely sustainable, authentic family business.
Well, I think this is an interesting factor that helps people's attitude. Mm. They think, well, it's local, so why does it cost the same as a bottle of champagne from Champagne?
Yeah.
And, of course, you can't make the quantities.
We are minuscule. So last year we made just over 400,000 bottles of wine. England, in total, made about 16 million bottles of wine. And just to put that in context, you know, Moët Hennessy, or Moët, the biggest producer of champagne, makes something like 30 to 40 million bottles, as far as we're aware. So they make more than the entirety of the UK's.
And their infrastructure has been there for centuries.
Exactly that. They are 350-year-old industries with a brilliant marketing strategy and historically and just to die for marketing
Providence,
strategy.
Yeah.
Exactly that. And they're brilliant products. No one's disputing it. And the us versus them rhetoric that was naturally around, I think, a while ago from various sort of publications, but it was an easy story of, you know, England beats champagne in a blind tasting or champagne beats England or whatever it is, the us versus them. I think we're getting beyond that narrative now. And it's just great wine is made all over the world. And the point of wine is it reflects where it comes from. And wine has it's had a pomp to it, and it's had this sort of slight snobbery that's always been slightly attached. And that's beginning to ebb away, I hope, and I think. And really, the Ridgeview thing is we just try and celebrate great wine of its place and of its time, and it tastes like where it comes from. That's the whole point of it. Simple as that.
And it is completely delicious. I'm going to go off to my next meeting slightly merry, having had a couple of glasses of this. But I don't care today.
Good, Jason.
Come on.
This is a lovely booking, isn't it? Thank you for this.
Perfect. I've never tried to do a job that didn't involve me pouring booze for people, so I've got no idea how this would be going if it wasn't alcohol.
Because your background is in restaurants in London. You started out, I think, initially as a waiter, then a maitre d',
literally
moved into being a sommelier.
Moved my way up for 3 years.
And you eventually ended up at the very famous Ivy. This is going to sound rude. The real Ivy.
I'm big into that, actually. Yes. And again, we'll walk that line carefully. But the proper Ivy.
I mean, as I've enjoyed going to the Ivy in the Lanes, and I have been there a few times now.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've always enjoyed it. It isn't the same experience.
I went there at the weekend. Actually, for the first time, I went to the launch party where Fatboy Slim was DJing, and it was all very sort of
very
bizarre.
Opulent.
But we went there for brunch actually on Saturday for the first time. And Olivia and I both said, it's lovely, it's brilliant, it's a great bistro, cafe. It's a really high-end experience. And there were people at the bar, and they were just having a lovely, lovely time. And the service was great, and the food was good. Good value, I thought, actually, genuinely. But it's not the Ivy. If it was under a different name,
there's
you'd think it's fantastic.
There's not the chance of seeing
a
Hollywood actor at the next table. There's not the chance of bumping into a best-selling author at the table, in the same way, the Ivy, the history of the place, and the atmosphere of the place. And I know it's changed over the years, and it's morphed, and it's modernised. Mm-hmm. All of them good things. But it still has that legacy, doesn't it?
There's something in the walls, isn't there? There's something just, and in the sort of leather banquettes, there's history there. And I really enjoyed it, because I worked in the private members club for the vast majority of all of that, the Ivy Club above it. And that opened in 2008, and I joined just after that. And a lot of the regulars and the really big names had migrated upstairs, because it had a bit more sort of secrecy to it. And it was privacy, exactly that. So we used to meet amazing people, and I was never starstruck. I really sort of prided myself on and found, just without trying naturally, that the whole point of the Ivy is that you treat everybody completely as equals, whether they're in this creative industry or another, and whether they happen to be the leading lady in a West End show at that point is sort of an irrelevance. Just give everyone a brilliant time. And there was one night, actually, that where we had Ricky Gervais and Stephen Merchant upstairs, Cilla Black was in the building, and it was fantastic. And I was running around, like an absolute sort of running around all over the place, came down to the piano bar, feeling sort of like everything was, lots of plates spinning, but everything's okay. Thought, I'm going to take a tray, that's all right. By this point, I was up further up within the management, and so I thought, I've got a bit of space and time, I'm going to take a tray, and I'm going to deliver it to a table, and as I do that, I'll look at the room. And I was busy looking around the room, and I rounded the very large pillar at the end of the room and collided with Michael Ball. And I'd never been stage-struck by anybody at all whatsoever. Cilla was upstairs, Ricky was there, all the rest of it, perfectly fine with that. And Michael Ball took my breath away like nobody ever has before, and he could see it in my eyes, and he knew that was
how
there.
Lovely. And he's a charming, charming man.
He was brilliant.
He was really nice. Fun. Sadly, we've run out of time. Oh. Jason, you're off to Richmond to be in pantomime.
Yes,
you're there
absolutely.
Until the new year.
Yep.
Good luck with that.
Thank you.
A great time. Tom, you'll be doing lots of events, I know.
We're running around all over the place. We've got a dinner at the Ginger Pig on Thursday, which is going to be fantastic. Ridgeview
Why
and
am I not
going
to back that?
To back.
Why am I not
I know.
That?
Well, have a word.
And the wines are in good wine merchants and
Thank
good
you.
Supermarkets.
Now, absolutely.
Which Butler's, is wonderful.
Butler's Wine.
I'll raise a glass to Ridgeview and to Miss Jason.
Lovely to be here.
Lovely
you're empty.
To me.
You
I am empty.
Empty.
The glass
is
empty.
Andrew.
Look at that.
Food.
Come on.
Well, you know what
and
to do
glass
about
to
that.
Watching
quiet.
This evening. We'll see you again in a week's time with more guests. And we're getting more and more Christmassy as the weeks go on. So expect to see me wearing something loud and bright
Come on.
In future.
Yes, please. Thank you.
We'll see you soon. Good night.
Look out.